Like whatever languages we used, if we have a parallel or concurrent processes, if we want to communicate between them or example share something, we actually share a memory, and then that's how we compute the parallel things, and then finally get the result. But that code is actually like in Golang it's slightly different, but rather you take an approach of like using channels and then communicate via them and not through sharing some memory. If it doesn't make sense, like the objective of this talk is to convince that. We'll go through a few examples. One is first we'll look at how do you have multiple goroutines and how do you actually coordinate between them. And the second would be like using locks or using channels. And the last one would be like in real world or in real services, how would you actually use it? Like I have a skewed examples. So let's start. So you all know StatsD, right? Like how you guys report some metrics to some Datadog or some Grafana or something, right? It's actually time secant based data, but you basically tell, hey, this is the key and this is the this is the number of occurrences. So this is somewhat similar to that. Like I took that as a sample. So if you have it, like example, like if you have a method called compute sum. At the end of your service at one day, like how many times it's being called, that is a metric you will capture. So imagine if we are implementing that, how would we go by it? As like we will ideally have a data with, which is a map of string to int, because this string will be the key, whatever key we want, and you will have a simple function of increment, like which takes a key, and then like you will have the counter keep on increasing at the end of the day, or you can actually group it by time and then know the value. So this is it, like this is straightforward, right? So now this is like I have 10 calls, like I'm just imitating that. I'm actually making 10 calls, and then I'm calling increment on that particular key, which is increment call, that is my function. And then you assert the total number of calls because I called it 10 times, so it should be same, right? Simple. So let's just test it. Go test. Yeah, so we'll just check it. So this works fine. So let's increase it. Increase the number of calls. Just a second. So I'm just increasing the number of calls and then calling it again. Okay. So give me a second. Yes, I forgot to do this. Okay, yes. So this I messed it. So in your program, basically stats will be a separate thing. You wouldn't want it to block the actual process, because of which you would ideally report it in a goroutine, right? So now given that like we will increment the numbers in goroutines, so now we will see the problem which I was thinking about. So yeah, so now it fails saying, hey, I actually made a 10 calls, but the result is 2. You could actually predict the reason because you are calling it in goroutines, but you are actually expecting the result way sooner than the actual goroutines completes. Because you make 10 calls, all the 10 goroutines have to be completed before you expect the result to be completed. So this is a problem. Now we want to coordinate between the channels. Simple, right? So how we will do it is even before that, like okay, yeah, how we will do it is we will actually have a mechanism of coordinating, which is it could be either lock or channels. But we let's just look at locks for now. Let's stick to coordinating first. So let's say this approximately takes 1 second. What you will do is I can say, hey, sleep for, let's say, 1 second, right? So I can actually sleep till it completes and then I can expect results. So which means ideally I would expect it to complete, right? But this means that you actually know how much time the processing takes, but it is not true in real world scenario because you wouldn't know how much time the processing takes. So this, though it's a naive approach, it works in some cases. It is not actually valid for most of the cases. So we can use sleep, just that's one point. let's say if you don't know how much time it takes, basically I can introduce a random sleep time inside the code, but the solution would be to something called wait groups. Okay. So what this wait group does is you can actually say, hey, I have n number of goroutines, and then I'm actually tracking n number of goroutines, and once all those completes, I can actually say, wait for all of the goroutines completion, and then you could finally get the result at that particular point of time. So what I can do is I can actually say, so this is the increment function, and I can say done. Sorry, I can say wait. So this means this will actually wait for it to complete, right? And but how will you tell like this process is complete, right? So I can actually say, how many goroutines we have in this case? We have 10 calls, so which means 10 goroutines will be available. So because of which I'll say, hey, track 10 goroutines. So now this is also given, but somebody have to tell each and every goroutine is completed, right? So because of which what we're going to do is, instead of calling this func and under goroutine, so I can say make this as a separate goroutine, okay, and then pass wg to it. So this will actually take a sync dot wait group. So now notice this, like you have to pass a pointer, if not it is not counted, because it'll be a separate value, like passed as a value, so it wouldn't actually reflect it. So now we did the same thing, since like the stats metric reporting is still in a separate goroutine, but rather you are tracking using a wait group, and then every goroutine it has the job of telling, hey, I'm actually completed. So that was this, like when I say done, that particular goroutine is completed, and in the main goroutine I'm saying, hey, there is 10 goroutines, and then wait for all of its completion. That's it. So now we can run the same thing. So I need to pass a pointer, right? So yeah, this is a different issue. We'll come back to that. Okay, so this problem is occurring, but I'm gonna just put some time dot sleep. I'll tell you what is the reason is some time sleep, and I'm gonna say go test, and well, still is fine. Okay, so the problem is now I have so many goroutines running, but underlying I'm actually changing the single map. So we'll keep this, like hold on to this. Like we use time dot sleep, but there is also a different way of using coordinating between goroutines, and that's actually wait groups. But now the problem is, whenever you have data shared, what is the problem, right? Because two parallel process, or two parallel goroutines in this case, is trying to access the same memory. It could read or it could write. If there is a write happening, and then if you read at the same time, it's basically a race condition, right? So that, I hope everyone gets it. So that is a problem which is occurring here. So basically all the goroutines is trying to mutate the data which you are actually communicating by sharing a memory. So the problem is it's concurrent map updates, because more goroutines are trying to update the underlying map. So what we have to do is, or what we could do is, one of the ways is use locks. Like that's the default thing we have used in pretty much other places. So there is sync package also has something called mutex. Basically the sync package, as you know, it's everything to do with synchronization. So what you could say is, so sync.mutex.lock. So you have to acquire the lock before the operation. And I'm going to do defer this, because you don't want to do it at the end, because you will have pretty much a lot of logic and you don't want to miss unlocking it, because then it will have a deadlock, right? So you lock, you acquire a lock, and then you unlock it once you actually do the completion, right? So now we did only that change. Let's see whether it works now, right? So now actually we don't need the time wait. So now it should work fine. Yeah, so it works fine. So we actually saw two things. One, we have so many goroutines. The moment you have a common shared memory, it has a problem of race conditions, because of which you have to lock. And though now the process is fine, But the actual other goroutines, you need to wait for its completion, because of which we used wait groups. Right? Makes sense. So given this, like if you have any questions, like basic thing, just ask, because we're gonna build on top of this now. Yeah.
So what happens is I use my goroutine is not intended to complete it, not maybe for end goal going in and
right.
I want to update some data is related to that goroutine and then update some metrics on that.
Yes.
And I want to do my goroutine will never complete.
Correct. Yes. So in that case, we would, I mean, in the forever loop, you could actually ideally use the get function, right? Like in the forever loop, the never ending thing, you could get the metric. But again, the problem would be, yes, now you're getting the data concurrently also. So because of which you would end up putting lock here also. So the problem would be like there is common shared memory. Like that is an underlying problem. Whether your process is running forever or it is running concurrently, it doesn't matter. Like next example I'm showing you is actually something like forever loop. Probably that would help. Like we'll look into that. So it is the same example, whatever we saw. So we have a key, which is a string, and then we are incrementing the count. So what we're going to do is this time slightly different. We have something called channel of string. Like who are all new to Go? Like haven't written code? Okay, cool. So the Go, when you call Go function, it was actually spinning up a Go routine. That means it's a separate thread sort of in with respect to other languages, but still it's green thread, not exactly same thread. And channel is something where you can imagine it as a pipe and everybody can send data to it. But the best part is it is synchronized internally, so which means you don't need to deal with locks or anything. So though you have millions of Go routines accessing the same channel, it wouldn't cause any problem. And you can actually send data and then read data at the same time. So literally you can imagine it as a pipe. So that is the channel. And the syntax is this. Like you have some occurrence, that's a variable. And my channel, that's a channel and it deals with string. So I can put string as the data and then I can read string from it. So that's it. So increment, right? The increment function, we had it over there. We incremented the map. But here what we're going to say is, there is an occurrence guy, I'm just saying, hey, this particular function, which is the key, is occurred, that's it. Now, who is going to do the job of counting, right? This is anyway skewed example. So this is what you were asking, right? So there is a forever loop. There is a forever loop because it's going to be running forever. And this guy is going to listen from the same channel and then it retrieves the key. And then it is going to update the underlying map. So it is literally skewed, but what we have achieved in this is even though you have millions of goroutines running and then saying increment function is called, there is only one goroutine and running on listening on one particular channel and reading sequentially. So we synchronized using a channel, though we wouldn't use it mostly. In this case, that's what we are doing. So and then we are updating the key because of which the lock, race condition will not, the concurrent map update will not happen in this case. And if you notice, when you call a new counter, you actually call the process method also. So which means you have a separate goroutine listening on that particular channel of string. And whenever you send data to it, this guy updates the map, underlying map. So this is it. So now we can actually see it. It's pretty much same. One difference is I need to end it somehow, right? Like since it's a forever loop, whenever I send a data end, I'm killing it here. It's a skewed example. We'll look at the better example next time. So, sorry. Yes. Yes. Sync dot? Okay. No, I like sync dot about you can use it. Like basically, that is actually what do you call that? Concurrent map. But my intention was to convey how do you use channels to communicate. Of course, we can use sync map underlying. Okay, we'll come back to that, but I haven't used sync.map. But my intention was to show channels and how do you coordinate between them. Yes?
If you go to that increment function,
Yes.
I think before that you mentioned regarding the loop part.
Which one?
Looping and unlooping.
Yes. Yes. So that is the previous example. Yes.
So, sorry
to
ask you.
Yeah.
So here I'm very new to Go related, but don't you think you are unlooping with the default, it should be done after.
Oh, sorry. Yes. So what this means is, this is actually means this.
Yeah.
Defer means you are actually calling the that particular method after the function is complete. So it, whatever we said defer, it's actually equivalent to this. So you do lock it, you do the operation, and then you unlock it. This is the same, it's just a syntactic sugar, because if there is complicated logic, people might, you know, it might unlock, you might miss unlocking. So because of which, Go has this syntactic sugar where you say defer, which means once the increment function is completed, you actually call the function.
Okay, defer will be called the next increment.
Yes, so which means after the increment function is completed, whatever you say defer, that will be executed after the increment. So which means you're actually acquiring lock, incrementing the data, then you're actually releasing the lock. So defer is executing this particular function after the normal function execution. That's it.
Cool.
Sort of. Yeah, yeah. Yes. So going back to this, so we have a separate goroutine which is listening on a channel, and then it reaches and updates the map synchronously, right? So now we have channel test. I'm doing the same thing here, which is I'm calling new counter, and yeah, I've already added some more extra things, but yeah, we have wait groups, same thing. Like I have 10 calls and then I am waiting for it. And then once all those is completed, I'm actually sending say end, because of which you will finally have the result. And we are actually asserting the number of calls should be equal to the expected calls. That's it. So all this time it was actually running, so we can actually see it. So yeah, the test concurrent increment channel is also working fine for us. But the, like, I was actually thinking to show the concurrency problem earlier. Ideally, it wouldn't happen if you have 10 goroutines or some less number of goroutines, but we can actually increase it to even thousands and then hundred millions, and it'll still work fine. So in this case, the only thing we got it is we are not using lock, and in our case, the processing time is very less, but if your computation is very, you know, if it takes some time, the lock will be much slower than the channel version of the thing. I've actually written a benchmark, but we'll go into that later, because it's little different and then it needs discussion around goroutines also. So this is that, right? Okay. So like I'll just show this, because you have a counter and then you have a wait group. Here also same thing. We are expecting 10 call or n calls to complete, and each and every function calls the increment, and then it says done, and then finally we are calling increment because we want to kill the forever loop, and then calling it. That's it. Okay. So yeah. So now this you got it right. You could either use a common data structure, which is a map, and then share it across goroutines, or use a channel, and then like literally here the test had some goroutines which sent the data, and then the actual process received the data. So I will actually point it out for the newcomers. So this, whenever you see some arrow mark going into channel, which means it's actually sending data to the pipe, and then here you're actually reading out of the pipe. So which means increment is actually sending data, and then here we are reading data out of it. That's it. So now, yes, so here if you have channels, right, channels is not, channels is obviously you would expect it to behave way faster, because you're not doing anything, you're just sending data and then you're done. But lock has internal implications, right, and because of which it takes more time. So we can actually see the benchmark then, since you asked. So I have metrics test, so which is actually the older metrics based on lock, and okay, I have the both the functions and the other test. So I have written benchmark function, and what this does is this is with lock, okay, this is with lock, and this is with channel, right? And then both places, we make n calls, right? That's it. So let's just see how the benchmark looks like. Yeah. Okay. Yes. So ideally, we would expect the channel to complete faster. But in this case, it's obviously lock is much faster than channels. The reason is how the channels work. When I actually have one channel, here you have only one receiver, but there is thousands of publishers, right? And because of which, whenever you publish data, once you read the data, then it waits for the second sender actually waits for it to consume. So the producer and consumer are in sync. So one more point, right? Like probably I'll go into that also. Then we have metrics channel. So you can actually say process. So here, I didn't have buffer earlier. So when you call something called make channel of string, default it's unbuffered. So which means, let's say there is hundreds of goroutines, everybody at the same shot sending I, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, each and everybody sending I to it. But there is only one receiver, because of which it reads 1, and then it reads 2, and then it reads 3. And also there is a catch is, the moment you read 1, then only the publisher also sends data, because this is not buffered. So since I don't have more buffer, this is going to take much more time. So the channel was taking 109, so now it's going to take much more time. So because the publishers is going to wait more. So is it visible now? So earlier it took 81, now it's going to take more time. So we can actually increment it and see it. So what this means is, I'm actually making a buffered channel, and then 100 people can send data at the same time. So it doesn't need to wait. So this should ideally give some time which is lesser than 109, let's see. Yeah, it pretty much takes the same time. But you got the concept, right? There is a wait introduced during the publishing time, and also, you know, the subscribing time. So there is a catch over there. This is a very skewed example, but in other cases, it'll be more evident. Like I can show you the other example. Yes. So this, right? So this particular thing from the println received data. Okay. I'm just printing received data in this. Okay. And so let's just run metrics. So this is metrics channel test. And then I'm going to run it for only 10 times. So go test FNV. So it says receive data, right? So let's just say we're going to introduce some sleep time under pushing, right? So time.sleep, time.second, 2 seconds, something, right? So we added a wait before pushing, right? So now let's just see. It's going to take 2 seconds and then receive data, 2 seconds and then, like, okay, in this case, we created a buffer channel, right? Because of which everybody sent data, but the receiver got it. We'll just remove this buffer and then this will be evident. So this is not a buffer channel anymore. And then let's just see whether okay, I'm missing something. So pushing data. So I was about to say, like, this will wait, you know, till you have some time. I mean, till you have the first data, this guy is actually going to wait. So that was my point. Probably I'll show it later. So obviously there is implication with channel, because you have to consider how many goroutines you have for listening, how many goroutines you have for publishing, because the channels could become a bottleneck. Because depending on the process, if you have 100 calls, if you have only 2 goroutines to process, your consumers are the bottleneck, right? If you have millions of publishers, then it could potentially break that particular worker. It's actually called worker pattern, but we can actually dive into that later. So, like, given that, we have seen we can use time.sleep to coordinate, and or the ideal way is to use waitgroup. And you could either share a concurrent data, either share a common memory, which is actually sharing some data, which is bad, or use a channel to communicate across goroutines. So now we could actually see some example where this example I was just writing now, where I have some n number of slice. I can actually have a slice with million record row. And then what I'm going to do is split the slice into multiple chunks and then ask the sub goroutines to compute the sub sum. So what it means is, so here I have, let's say, split jobs, right? So I have 10 records. If I want to split it into two and then compute it, there is a separate goroutine computing from 0 to 4 and then the other goroutine computing from 5 to 9, like the first set and second set. So this guy is actually splitting that part, and then only this part notice. So this is actually data you are splitting it. So let's just add println start end date. Yeah, start and end split. Okay, so this guy is actually splitting it, and there is a other guy which is actually calling, summing the data. So you receive some data, and then you're looping through it and then summing it. Leave the second part, we'll come to that later. So let's say go test it. Should have removed the sleep, we'll just remove it. Yeah, so okay, the split, the function I called is different. So what I'm gonna say is 100 instead of 100, I'm gonna say, okay, so this is benchmark and this is N100. So I'm gonna say, so there is 10 elements in array, and then I'm gonna split it into two chunks and then compute it. That's set. So go test run. I'm gonna say sum concurrency. Okay. So what did, if you notice, right? So there is a split of, sorry, the split is actually the number of elements. So in this case, it's split into two elements, and then each and every, there are multiple goroutines summing that part. So there is one more thing I can actually show you. Okay, it quickly completed. So let me just increase it. This is 100 and then this is 5. So 100 data, there is a split of 5. So I'm just gonna add a little sleep in some place. So I'm just gonna say it's time of sleep, 1000. I just added a sleep in the separate goroutines. Okay. Your concurrency test. Yeah. So there is a library called grmon. What this guy does is, it's actually, you can actually track the goroutines and he will be able to show you that particular thing. That's what I'm trying to do. Okay, it's not visible. I'll just try once more. If it doesn't work, we can just move on. grmon start. So you just need to call grmon start, and it should work fine. I'm just checking why it's not working. So I call grmon start, and I have a sleep. I'm sleeping for 2 seconds. Yeah. So you could see n number of goroutines pinned up here, and the split is higher, right? So we can actually reduce it and see how it works. There should be only, there is 100, right? So let's just say 50 split into 50 data. So there's only two goroutines which is sleeping. Like all the sleep which you noticed, this guy is actually computing that sub sum, like summing the subset slice and then returning the results. So I hope I set the context. Now we can actually look into the code, and then like if you have questions, probably ask. So this is a place where we are instantiating a separate goroutine to sum the slice, right? So this is the first step. This is where the sub workers are created to sum it. And if you notice here, let's go to this implementation here now. So I'm saying defer WG done, because I'm saying like, hey, this is separate goroutine. Once I'm completed, I'm notifying the actual master work goroutine. And one more thing, if you notice, is I'm passing a channel, which is channel of int. This, what this means is, this you can actually only send integer to the channel. And if the symbol is otherwise, you can actually only receive from the channel. That's what this means. So either you could send, you can only send data. So this is only writable, and the other could be only readable. It's just for, you know, sort of safety. So what you see here is you loop through the each and every elements, and then you send the data back to the channel, not returning the result, right? So I hope this makes sense. Separate goroutine, summing over the sub slice, and then returning the value sum into a channel, right? So now this guy is a collector, right? Like now you have a separate workers computing a sum of sub slice. There should be a worker who aggregates the sum and then sum it, right? So this is doing that. So now you have a total, like this guy is summing all the subsums, right? So this is a subsum channel. This is the same channel which is shared across the other subworkers and the master worker, right? And what you are saying is, hey, get me the data and then I'm summing it. And that's it, okay? So, and then let's just print it, right? Like let's just print the statements. So this is the subsum computed by the workers, and then you are summing that also. And so let's see here. So you're actually creating a channel sum here, and then you're passing that sum to collector, right? This is the collector which takes subsum, and if you notice, this is the channel which is shared across the subroutines also. So this sum, if you notice. So every goroutine is computing a sub-slice sum and then putting into this particular channel. And the same channel is used by the collector and receiving the results. Now you have like 10 elements. If you split by 5, there is one goroutine which is computing the result of first 5 and then second goroutine resulting result of the second 5. That is into a channel. Now you computed that result also. But how do you end it, right? How do you know it's end? So what you do is, you have to tell from the master channel, hey, close the sum channel. So what I did here is, if you have 100 elements in a slice, and if you have 10 goroutines, I wait for 10 goroutines to complete. And this particular collector is a forever running goroutine, right? So once that 10 goroutine is completed, I'm closing the sum channel. So what this means is, when a guy actually receiving from that channel, if that channel is closed, it will receive a not okay. So this is basically means you're actually reading from a channel which is closed. So it is not allowed. So this is a safer way to read. And whenever a channel is closed, you're saying it's a total sum because all the 10 goroutines are completed and all the results are you got it. And the master channel said there is no more goroutines to compute the subsum. So now you're actually closing the channel, and here this guy actually sends the result back to another channel. So literally we don't have any locks in this place, right? And then the only way of sharing data is through communicating. I hope you got the point, right? Like the subroutines communicates with some channel, and the collector actually communicates with the total sum channel, right? So now this guy actually receives the data from sum and then prints it. Cool. So we can actually see it, how it works. So every data is split, and there is a collector receiving data. And then finally, you're receiving the data from collector. And this collector prints total sum once it's complete. Every time it receives a subsum, it prints that data, right? And then this guy doesn't do anything, okay? Let's just run this particular test and see. This is test sum concurrency, same thing. So if you notice, it computed this separate sum, and then it got the final sum, right? We can actually increment it to see how it goes. So now if you have 10 data, each goroutine computes 10 subsets and then passes it. So the slice is split into 10, 10, 10. This is the collector job. Collectors receive subsum every time. And then finally, once everything is complete, you got the total sum, right? But we didn't, I don't know how, if it was a Java, you would ideally share a common variables and then update that memory, right? And the moment you have a common shared thing, the problem is concurrency, and then concurrent writes and concurrent reads, and that will result in a problem. So so because of which, that's why the whole concept is totally different, where share by communicating and not communicate by sharing. That's the proverb, what it means. So I'll just run one benchmark and then I'm done. Like probably I can take the questions. So here, if you notice, we are summing it, and then this is the number of subsets, right? Sub slices. So if I say one, it's obviously gonna take long time. Test benchmark. I'm just gonna benchmark, and then I will benchmark some concurrency. Yes, some concurrency. So just see this. Leave that. That's okay. We printed it. So it obviously took long time, right? So let's just get rid of the printer lens. Okay, cool. So now I'm just running it. Obviously, we know it's taking more time. In the meantime, I'm just gonna say, you know, this, I'm gonna say 200 data or 300 data, right? And then I'm just gonna run grmon and grmon. Right. Yeah. So now, like the moment you increase the number of separate goroutines, the time which it takes will obviously reduce. So in this case, it's 16051. Earlier, it was much higher. So if we increase it again, let's say 500, right? Not 500. Yeah, it's fine. Like literally, there is so much goroutines running. Yeah, so the time it took is reduced, but also the problem is number of goroutines increase, the context switching, all those come into picture. So to your question, right, or the point which I was making earlier, if you have so much of data, you have to tweak the number of publishers and also the number of workers who process the jobs. So in this case, we give a slice and then computing sum is the job. Imagine that is the job. In our ideal case, it could be like making a service call and then making a payment and stuff like that. If you have millions of job, if your throughput is like 1000 RPM, obviously you would have to have that many number of workers listening onto this particular, you know, listening out to the same channel and then process it so that the stream is not a bottleneck. Like you obviously have to have more worker to process. And if you have too much workers, the problem is you have less requests, but you have so many workers and the workers are idle, and because of which there is also a cost which you do for context switching. So that also you have to consider it. I mean, ideally we could have a separate talk which talks about context switching, goroutines, and how do you manage the worker process, everything. But you can actually go and look into a worker pool concept where I think there's a lot of talks which talks about how do you throttle the request, and the requests are sent to workers, like even HTTP requests, and the workers process it and then finally return the result. So that would be a good thing to check for channels, and how do you use channels, and then how do you tweak that. So I think I've covered pretty much everything. Like, so whenever you have a concurrency, how do you coordinate is with time sleep or wait group. And when you say communicate by sharing, you have a underlying common data, and then you have to have locks. There is actually two things. One is mutex. This mutex is actually exclusive lock. You can actually look at read write mutex. What you can do is acquire read locks separately and write locks separately. So it means there can be multiple readers concurrently. Only writes will lock the other process. So this is better, obviously, performance sake. Like you will lock only whatever required. So this is that. And share by communicating means you use channels. And yeah, that's it. That's all I had. And if you want to look at the code, I will actually commit this into my GitHub. Actually, I'll share the link. And if you have any questions, reach out to me, and yeah, we could actually talk. Yep, thank you. If you have any questions, I'm going to take now.